Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Thank you all for coming. My name is Will Carey. I'm Director of Annual Giving Programs here. And before we even get started, I have one quick bit of housekeeping, which is that one of our docents informed me that there is a black Audi in the parking lot. License plate begins with JFK that has its flashers on. So if that's your car, you might want to go out and turn those hazards off. Want to thank you for being here as we hear Barbara Beaucar's talk on music at the Barnes Foundation. In addition to her talk, the Barnes is proud to have many new music programs, including our Resounding Voices Choral Series and our Solo Series. And both of these programs are free or discounted for members. We encourage you to keep an eye on your monthly emails if you're interested in attending these. We send promotions out about them all the time. They're absolutely fantastic programs, and we hope if you have not yet attended one of these that you will, because we've really been making a push to do more music here. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Barbara Ann Beaucar. The Barnes has been lucky to have Barbara on staff as our archivist for more than 14 years. She retired in 2002 to process the correspondence of Dr. Barnes, a project that took more than 4 years to complete. His letters span the years of 1902 to 1951, and since he wrote to practically everyone, they include more than 22,000 files. As a result, Barbara has become intimately familiar, perhaps more familiar than anyone else, with the life of Dr. Barnes, the development of his educational program, and the formation of his art collection. Currently, Barbara manages our archives, libraries, and special collections department. She has been instrumental in prioritizing the preservation and reorganization of the Barnes archives and special collections, which were moved from Marion out here to our Parkway campus last year. The goal of this move was to create a research center that would serve the Barnes Foundation staff and students, as well as visiting scholars researching the history of the Barnes and its collections. Through her work, Barbara has uncovered the pivotal role that music played in the life of Dr. Barnes and the unmistakable ways it can still be felt in the collection today. Please join me in welcoming Barbara Ann Beaucar.
Thanks so much, Will, and thank all of you. You came out on such a horrible day. I really appreciate it. And I'm sure, let me also say thank you to all of you who are members of the Barnes. I know our membership team probably thanks you and shows their appreciation all the time, but just let me add my voice to that. We staff people really appreciate the way in which you support our mission, so thank you. I've been here a long time, and the first project I had was to process Dr. Barnes's correspondence, which took me years to do. But it's not only in the correspondence, we also have a really wonderful collection of recorded music. We found in the ephemera collection program invitations, all kinds of pieces, puzzle pieces I call them, that once put together really reveal what an important part music was to Dr. Barnes, both on a personal and professional level. But also these objects appear to reveal that music was also a very, very important part of the early Barnes educational program. It once functioned actually as part of the classes, the art classes that were taught at the Barnes Foundation. And I think it's one of those underreported stories about this institution. So I'm happy this morning, this afternoon now, to have the opportunity to talk about music at the Barnes. I think in the opinion of many, people would say that that Barnes collected one of the world's greatest art collections, but in my opinion, he may have actually had a greater affinity for music. In these photographs shot by Pierre Matisse, Dr. Barnes is holding a 78 RPM recording. He's preparing for one of his Sunday lectures, which he also called demonstrations. These are lectures in which he made connections between music and art, and sometimes between individual composers and artists. Along the north wall, let me get my little pointer out here, right back there, that's the old Victrola that he used to play recorded music. I would say probably, I was looking actually this morning for the date, I think it was late in the 1940s, he replaced the old Victrola with the Magnavox that's up in the main gallery now. At the time, it was a state-of-the-art instrument, so I think that probably most of you might know that that's a record player, but I think a lot of our visitors mistake it for, you know, a part of the ensemble, and I believe it still works. I think it's really wonderful that it's still there, just standing there as a silent testimony to Dr. Barnes's deep commitment to music. And there's Dr. Barnes and Fidel. The educational program at the Barnes Foundation was inspired by Dr. Barnes's teacher and friend, the American philosopher John Dewey. Barnes believed that learning was experiential, and his vast collection of art and the wall ensembles that he created in the gallery serve as an educational vehicle for the study of art appreciation and aesthetics. The Barnes-Dewey method included experiencing original works of art, participating in class discussions, reading about philosophy and the traditions of art, and looking objectively at the artist's use of light, line, color, and space. Dr. Barnes often removed paintings from the walls in other rooms and arranged them for his lectures in the main gallery. Thank you. We don't do that anymore. Barnes believed that students would not only learn about art from these experiences, but they would also develop their critical thinking skills, something that both he and Dewey thought would enable them to become more productive members of a democratic society. So there was really sort of a deeper motive. Remember, the Barnes Foundation was chartered in 1922 as an educational institution. It was never an art museum. We don't know what music Barnes listened to as a young man. He was a student at the University of Pennsylvania in the late 1880s and early 1890s, the very years that American popular music was born. I wonder if he listened to ragtime. I don't know. There's no records from when he was a young man. But we do know that he loved spirituals and folk songs. And he claimed that as a child, he had tinkered with the flute and the violin. And he said, as a result, he translated most things into music equivalents. Dr. Barnes married Laura Leggett of Brooklyn in 1901, and I always give her credit for developing his love of classical music. By 1905, Barnes's business had become so successful that he was able to build his estate home in Marion, just outside of Philadelphia. He named it Lauriston after his bride. The two fox hunted, they traveled, they collected art, and they both held season tickets to the Philadelphia Orchestra. From 1915 to 1918, Dr. and Mrs. Barnes hosted Sunday music halls at their home, and they invited their neighbors to join them. In this 1917 letter, Leopold Stokowski, the renowned conductor of the Philadelphia Orchestra, and his wife, Olga, were invited to hear the Brazilian pianist, Giomar Novares, perform, and Barnes added that they might want to come early and see his paintings. It's probably safe to say that French pianist Jean Verde and Russian violinist Vasily Berezovsky were favorites with Dr. and Mrs. Barnes. The two were sometimes invited to perform solely for the Barneses on Saturday night, and then they would stay over for the Sunday programs. After Jean Verde had departed to defend his country in the First World War, he and Dr. Barnes maintained a very warm correspondence. They, in fact, corresponded with each other for 22 years. Dr. Barnes closed this letter to Jean Vert. I guess you can't read it very well, but I have the quote there. It's one of my favorite quotes from Dr. Barnes. "There's nothing new here except a fox terrier pup, aged 2 months, who has been christened Jean Vert Jr." And I always wonder what the famous French pianist thought about that, having a little puppy named after him. Dr. Barnes noted that a lot of musicians in America, especially violinists, did not have first-class instruments to play. In 1917, he purchased a Francesco Ruggieri violin from the Rudolf Wurlitzer Company and presented it to Beaucar. It was his to play with the stipulation that it couldn't be taken out of the country and he must provide insurance for it. There's always a few strings attached with Dr. Barnes. I'm sorry. When Mr. Beaucar died 2 years later, Barnes tried unsuccessfully to sell the instrument. So it remained in a closet in Marion until his death in 1951. In 1952, the Philadelphia Orchestra Association acknowledged Mrs. Barnes for her great generosity in presenting the Francesco Ruggieri Cremona 1682 to the Philadelphia Orchestra in the memory of Dr. Barnes. And of course, this begs the question, doesn't it? Is it still there? I've given this talk a couple times before, and I always get that question, and I have an answer this time. We contacted the orchestra, and at first, the people that we contacted didn't know anything about the violin. So we were under the impression that perhaps the orchestra had sold it. But I don't know if Marshall Portnoy is here today, but he's very, very dedicated and also has some friends at the orchestra and did a little bit of sleuthing for us. He contacted his friend, who is one of the vice presidents for advancement at the orchestra, and I got an email from him. "The Ruggieri violin donated by Mrs. Barnes is currently being played by our assistant concertmaster, Mark Rovetti." He also sent us a receipt appraisal by Wilbur Walmsley in Haddonfield, New Jersey. The instrument is worth $550,000. So I don't know how many of you have tickets to the orchestra or go to the orchestra, but when you do, look at he's the assistant concertmaster, and just take note that he's playing our violin, which I think is just a wonderful story. Dr. and Mrs. Barnes had a long association with the Philadelphia Orchestra, and they knew two of its most celebrated conductors, Leopold Stokowski and Eugene Ormandy. When the Barnes Foundation in Marion was officially dedicated in 1925, Dr. Barnes asked Stokowski to speak on behalf of the art community. I think it's really interesting that he didn't ask a painter or a sculptor to speak. He asked a musician. Stokowski agreed with a perfectly concise answer, "I will do it because I believe in your idea." It also appears from the 1945 letter that Eugene Ormandy visited the foundation. He said he was guided through the incomparable collection of paintings and art objects. And then he sent his regrets for being unable to attend one of Dr. Barnes's demonstrations on the kinship between great composers and great painters. There's a lot of evidence about Dr. Barnes making these comparisons. It's impossible to mention the Barnes' association with the orchestra without sharing this excerpt from a letter in which he asked for his seats to be changed. Barnes frequently did this. A lot of the letters in the correspondence he's writing to complain about something. Apparently, the lady that was seated in front of him insisted on wearing a large hat to performances. So he began by saying, "The only things I got from the concert this afternoon were a bad pain in the neck and the emotion which prompts this letter." I don't know what they did about it. If they talked to the lady or they moved his seats. Dr. Barnes also developed relationships with composers. In the summer of 1933, composer Nicholas Nabokov received a scholarship to attend foundation classes. Barnes also arranged for him to play some of his scores for Stokowski. Some recent scholarship that's been done in the archives, it indicates that Barnes was constantly pushing Stokowski to actually be more progressive, which is really saying something if you know Stokowski. By the fall of 1933, Nabokov was named the Foundation's Director of Music Education and lectured every other Sunday. The aim was to show that all good modern music is based upon the old traditions, which is the same thing that we do with the art. Nabokov selected recordings of everything from Bach to jazz, from Haydn to Javanese music. We recently had a really wonderful summer intern who stayed on with us to volunteer through the winter. And lucky us, it turned out that her undergraduate degree was in music performance, and her graduate degree was in library and information science. So she processed our recorded sound collection, which of course once belonged to Dr. Barnes. And she found a couple of things about it. She said that it was really interesting that a lot of the recordings actually record the composer who wrote the music, which is kind of unusual and makes those records worth a little bit more. And she said also she really believed that because of Nabokov coming and teaching and requesting all of these various kinds of music. She said that the diversity of the collection's not very big, you know, as record collections go, but the diversity is really quite remarkable, and she credited Nabokov for this. So in a letter to David Reisman, Barnes explained that on Sundays that they still had music programs, but music had, in fact, become incorporated as part of the regular educational program, which is why I said, you know, there is evidence that it wasn't just Barnes. It had actually become part of the educational program here at the Foundation. So including the music as part of the educational program actually continued through the 1940s. Instructor Violet DeMasi explained to a correspondent from Mexico City that the foundation teachers apply the same method, scientific method of appreciation to the study of musical composition as to the study of painting. And for practical purpose, the teachers use Victrola records. These are Dr. Barnes's notes, his lecture notes that we found in the education records. He wrote many notes for his demonstrations connecting music and art, and he made connections between composers and artists to show the kinship, for example, between Beethoven and Cézanne, Gluck and Renoir, Mozart and Prendergast, Picasso and African-American spirituals. And for some, he made a direct comparison between a certain piece of music and a certain work of art. I have a series of slides with music. I'm going to talk a little bit about the first one. It's I think I can go ahead and show it to you before I started playing. This is one of Dr. Barnes's comparisons. He compared Beethoven's Symphony No. 5, first movement, with Paul Cézanne's Card Players. One of our docents and some of our former foundation students told me that Ms. DeMasia used to actually conduct in front of this painting to the fifth. I think what she was trying to do is point out the very large masses. Dun, 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 dun. So you'll see. Honestly, I find it personally very difficult to find, make the connection. I'm going to see what you think. There'll be time at the end of my talk for questions and perhaps maybe a little discussion about these comparisons. Let me just get this started. Oop, sorry. Think? Maybe? Okay, with this one, this is I'm probably going to mispronounce it, Orfeo ed Eurydice by Gluck. It's the Andante, and I compared it to one of Barnes's favorite Renoirs, The Bathing Group. These two specific, this painting and this specific piece of music I chose. He never really mentioned exactly which Gluck and which Renoir. Okay, the next one is Mozart and Prendergast, and this is another one of Dr. Barnes's comparisons. He chose Symphony No. 40 in G minor, and this is Prendergast's Marble Head Harbor. Oop, I keep pushing the wrong button here. A little bit better, yeah. In The Art of Henri Matisse, one of the books that Barnes wrote with Violet Damasia, he devoted an entire chapter comparing the work of Henri Matisse to Igor Stravinsky. And personally, I find the written word, comparing music and art, it means a little bit more to me. I understand it a little bit better. He said both are extremely colorful, but Matisse's color and Stravinsky's sound seem raucous and at variance with what in other artists we have learned to expect. We are constantly surprised by the audacity of both men, surprised to the point of being disturbed. And he went on to explain that these art forms were simply the newest addition to a long tradition in art and music, and that over time, they would become accepted and appreciated. And he was right. I have another sound slide for you. This one, I put this together. I chose these two pieces to support Barnes's comparison of Matisse and Stravinsky. Ready Spring. I'm sorry. Should have. It's the scenes from Pagan Russia. Augurs of Spring. Barnes claimed that he attended camp meetings when he was a boy. His mother, Lydia Schaefer Barnes, was a devout Methodist and may have taken him to these summertime religious meetings where African Americans sang spirituals. He said he never recovered from the thrill. As one of the first collectors of African art, Dr. Barnes was also the first to define African art as an art form rather than as an anthropological object. In the spring of 1926, he set out equipped with lantern slides to speak to the Women's Faculty Club at Columbia University about African art. For this talk, he had hoped to include some spirituals with his slide lecture, and he asked Charles S. Johnson of the National Urban League for help finding singers in New York City. Johnson suggested he contact Frederick J. Work, the music director at the Manual Training and Industrial School for Youth in Bordentown, New Jersey. He highly recommended their Bordentown Glee Club. He said he'd heard them and been transported. Dr. Barnes was also transported by Frederick Work's young singers. He invited them to perform at the Barnes Foundation's gallery on April 4th, 1926, as part of a program that featured the Paris art dealer Paul Guillaume speaking on African art, art professor Dr. Thomas Monroe demonstrating the influence of African art on modernist painters, Charles S. Johnson reading African American poetry, and Dr. Barnes speaking on African music. At the Foundation of Mary and the Bordentown Glee Club performed almost annually on Sundays from 1926 to 1950. And over the years, a wonderful friendship developed between Dr. Barnes and Frederick Work. They corresponded from 1926 until Mr. Work's death in 1942, exchanging holiday cards and recipes. And I have a note here to remind me to tell you. One of the recipes that we have in the archives is from Mr. Work. It's for turtle soup, which was one of Dr. Barnes's favorites. And not only did he send him the recipe for the turtle soup, he sent him the turtle too. Here's another sound slide. This is Climbing Up the Mountain, Children. It's a spiritual, and I'm going to play it along with Pablo Picasso's Violin, Sheet Music, and Bottle.
Climbing up the mountain, children, what a deep
This is again one of Dr. Barnes's comparisons. The Reverend Charles Albert Tinley was born on Maryland's Eastern Shore in 1851. After emancipation, he learned to read, studied for the ministry, and began preaching in Philadelphia. It's around the same time that Barnes launched his first company in Philadelphia. He was a gifted composer and is best known for launching what was then a new form of sacred music in America, the gospel hymn. And that was based on the traditions of African-American spirituals. His works include I'll Overcome Someday, which was the anthem of the civil rights movement in the 1960s. They changed the words a little bit. And our rare books collection holds a copy of Reverend Tinley's hymns, The New Songs of Paradise. It was published in Philadelphia in 1916. His church, the Tinley Temple, United Methodist Church, opened in 1924. Barnes attended services at the temple. Of course, he wrote to complain about the poor acoustics that they had there. He delivered a speech, actually, though, on April 9th, 1931, about African-American artists, poets, and musicians. Both in 1931 and 1932, at the onset of the Great Depression, Barnes donated money to cover 1 week's expenses for feeding the poor and Reverend Tinley's congregation. And as usual, his gift was made anonymously. And this I call the legacy. And I selected these two musicians in particular. Both African-American artists and musicians were recipients of scholarships to attend classes at the foundation, also to travel abroad, or to study at other schools. As early as 1928, Dr. Barnes anonymously contributed to a fund to send young violinist David Auld to Juilliard. In 1942, Lillian Hall, who sang with the Bordentown Glee Club, received a scholarship to attend Westminster Choir College in Princeton. But I think the most interesting of all the scholarship students was Adeline Lockhart. She was a graduate of the University of California. In 1942, she received both a scholarship to attend the traditional three-year program here at the Barnes, and also a traveling scholarship to study African-American folk music and spirituals in the South. Her letters recounting her experiences in Tennessee, Alabama, Florida, and South Carolina, along with the transcriptions of the songs she heard there, I believe are historical treasures. She sent her transcriptions of spirituals to Dr. Barnes for safekeeping while she traveled from one rural area to the next. We have many of them, and they're still in her files in the Barnes Foundation's archives. Just as a note, she didn't go on to pursue a career in music. She got married. She moved to the Watts section of Los Angeles in California, and became very active in her community. In fact, she helped launch a community college and also a medical center in Watts. In 1943, organist Kenneth Goodman received a scholarship to study at the foundation and also at Juilliard, where he earned a diploma in 1949. Dr. Barnes thought Goodman's compositions reflected the principles expounded and demonstrated in the classes here at the Barnes Foundation, and that he applied them to his own work to attain a distinctive personal individual expression without a trace of eclecticism. In 1952, more than a year after Barnes's death, the Barnes Foundation reactivated Goodman's music fellowship for one more year of study in Paris with organist and composer Marcel Dupré. Altogether, Goodman spent over a year and a half studying and performing on radio and in person in Europe, Scandinavia, and England on fellowships from the Barnes Foundation. And finally, I'll let you read this quote. It's it was written by Dr. Barnes in a letter to Kenneth McGowan in 1942. And he was talking about the Bordentown Glee Club and just how important they were to the students here at the Barnes. I think it's especially important to note that he considers the concerts the epitome of our whole educational program. So this concludes my talk for today. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Yes?
So I'm curious in your review of Barnes's letters, whether he comments at all on Walt Disney's Fantasia, which would seem to try to do the same kind of thing that he's trying to do.
Right. Yeah, the question was about, was there any comment from Barnes on Walt Disney's Fantasia? And no, I'm sorry to say, I've never come across any notes on that. But yeah, that's an interesting point. Yeah, anyone else? Anyone have any comments about the music and art pairings?
Did Dr. Barnes do his own typing, or did he?
No, he had secretaries, yeah. Well, he did say he tried to learn the flute and the violin, but I think he did that when he was very young. And, he said he tried to paint as well. So he was very interested in the arts, but no, as an adult, I don't think that he never played an instrument. Yes? Well, the only evidence I've found so far, as far as the music scholarship, were the ones that they extended to Kenneth Goodman. After Barnes died up to, I guess, 54, they were still offering Kenneth Goodman scholarships to study in Europe. The scholarships that were provided by Dr. Barnes were really more of a stipend for living expenses because there was no tuition at the Barnes at the time, so it was free to attend classes. And he did give a lot of scholarships to artists as well so that they could live and work in the Philadelphia area and take classes. We have a lot during his lifetime, but afterwards, a lot of those papers haven't been processed as much as I'd like them to be. So maybe we'll come up and find some more information on that eventually.
But to your knowledge, that's not continuing.
No, not today, no. Well, no, actually, no, we do have scholarships. I think that's a new program. I can't really speak to that, but I think we do have some spaces in our classes now. It's something that just, I think, rolled out last fall, actually. Not the kind of scholarships that he offered, but we do offer, I think, 5 seats are available for scholarship students. Yes?
In terms of demonstrations, what you do, mm-hmm. is that something similar that Barnes would have done with the Victrola and people?
Yeah, exactly. The notes that I showed you, those are his notes where he's pairing the various composers and artists. And in some cases, there's an actual piece of music and a work of art that he's paired. So I tried to show you those. He would have done that. I don't know that he did that for every lecture, but he was the one that started it, and it was continued. As I said, with Ms. Demasia, continued with it as well, at least through the 40s. But I've talked to people who have taken classes with her or took classes with her in the 70s and 80s, and I think she was still using music. So yeah, it is interesting, yeah. I'm sorry, I should have repeated that question.
Are there
The question, are there further notes as to why he paired the pieces? And unfortunately, no. I think that in the book, the chapter that he devoted to Matisse and Stravinsky, that's where he really expounds upon it. His notes are very much like the notes, probably like your notes, anyone's notes. I actually have my notes written out a little bit more explicitly, but usually when we have notes, they're kind of rough. And there's a few words here and there where he'll say something about rhythm or pattern or something, but he doesn't really explicitly say why he's picked those two. Anyone else? Oh, back there, yes?
I found it easy in the first two paintings to understand the pairing, particularly the chord players. I found that da-da-da-da, for me, was the anticipation of playing a chord game and wondering what your next move was, and then the related action when the sound got a little bit slower. And I found that also true of the bathers who were getting nude and kind of looking at
That's really interesting. Can you all hear her? Yeah, okay. She was saying that the pairings for the first two made more sense to her, and I think they make least sense to me. You know, the card players are blue, and there's these three very large figures, and there's something about the structure of it, and I see them. It's winter time. It's cold out. They're huddled around the table. Yeah, but I see something that would be more blue and maybe something more somber. And then with the nudes, I would say think of something lighter, you know, and something a little bit more pastoral, you know. So yes. You're saying he didn't believe the subject. Yeah. It was the composition. Yes, that's very true. We're looking at it in terms of light, line, color, and space, not in terms of card players. So maybe if we turned the paintings upside down, so we'd get away from the subject, and we just looked at the masses, and we looked at the color and the line, And then we listen to the music. Maybe then it would make more sense. Maybe more sense to me. Yes?
This is not the same thing, but I was reminded of Edward Albee, who lived with Oscar Hammerstein, mm-hmm. who credits his music background to his playwriting as far as pacing and timing.
Oh, that's really interesting. Yeah. Well, there again, have any of you read the book Painting in Tears? Yes, okay. I'm just reading that now. And you know, a lot of it I'm relating to some of the things that Barnes taught us, you know, how to approach a painting. And I also did a lot of thinking as I was reading it too. A painting is actually kind of timeless. It doesn't have time. Music has time. Time is the logic of music. And books and plays all have time. They have beginning, middle, and end. So I could see music working with the structure of a play for the timing of that. But I personally have a problem connecting music with art. Art stay still. And I've said all along, it makes it a really great vehicle for teaching, because it stays there. And you can sit and observe it. You don't need to sit and listen to the beginning, middle, and end. It can be there. It can be there while I'm talking. And you can, it has a presence. And so that's, I think, one of the reasons why I find it difficult to compare music and painting.
It would make sense to me if you know the artist was listening.
A lot of artists do, yeah. The comment was made, it would make sense if you knew what music the artist was listening to, if they were listening to music while they were working, so. The question was about Mrs. Barnes. Did she have any other influence in music? No, I don't know of any. Unfortunately, most of her papers were destroyed. The papers that we have for her are very administrative letters to the students in the horticulture program, letters to seed companies and various arboreta. So I really don't think that there was any more connection with music. She seemed very, very devoted to the classes out in Marion in the arboretum. The movement, yeah. Yeah, there's this was another comment about Miss Demasia comparing Renoir and trees and Cézanne and trees and finding connection in the movement. And I can see that. Apparently Miss Demasia would conduct and got very, very active in front of the paintings while she was, you know, having her students listen to music. So maybe it made more sense. But yes.
Is the concept of music and art still part of the curriculum today here at the Beaucar?
Well, I personally have a very good friend who teaches here, and maybe some of you have taken classes with Leslie Bowen. Do you know Leslie? Leslie does one class where she has you sit in front of the Joy of Life, and she plays, I think she plays Stravinsky and Debussy, and she has you listen to the music and just sit with the work, and then she changes from one composer to the other. And most of her students say that, and I think this is really interesting, that the painting looks different depending on what piece of music they're listening to. But she and I, of course, have commiserated about music at the Barnes, and we've talked a lot about this. So she's incorporated at least that much into her class. I don't know about the other teachers, if they're using music to this extent. I don't know. Yes?
This fall, we'll be teaching Martha Lucy, Catherine, and myself will be teaching a 20th century art and music class.
Okay. There you go. Okay, so it looks like look to the future. It's coming back. Is there any other questions? Yes? I think you're probably right. The comment was is that Barnes was probably looking at the structure, not so much the subject of the music and the art. And I think you're right. I guess this is just me personally. I think that what I bring to music, I'm not very knowledgeable, I don't think, although it's been part of my life for all of my life. But I was a painter. I went to art school. That was my first career. I was a painter. I didn't listen to music when I worked. I felt it asked too much of my attention. When I listen to music, I want to listen to music. I don't want to be doing anything else. So I think that's part of the problem I have, putting the two together. But I think you're right. And I think before, I mean, it sounds funny to turn things upside down, but when I used to teach painting and drawing, I would oftentimes do that with my students. I'd have them turn a photograph upside down and then draw it. And it's just a way of getting into the right side of your brain, where you're not thinking about subject, you're not thinking about naming things, you're not thinking about time either. You're just thinking about space and space relationships. Maybe if I turned the paintings upside down, and I don't know, if I did something to trick myself, maybe perhaps could begin to see and compare the forms and the structure. Anyone else? No more questions? Yes. Ah, you're welcome. I'm really happy you said that. Yes. Thank you. Thanks so much.
For further exploration of relationships between artists and musicians, painters and musicians, there's a book by Relationship of Schoenberg and Kandinsky, the writer.
Boy, there's a comparison. That'd be great, yeah. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for coming out in the rain.